morning and welcome to our online service here at Bentley Baptist Church. It's Good Friday and Joel will be sharing the word with us this morning. We're going to have a short time of worship, but before we do, let us pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this Easter time. Lord, we pray that the word that's shared this morning speaks directly to us. Lord, thank you that you love us. Thank you that you're here with us. Jesus' name, amen. Let us worship.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. One final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The sun
and blameless life. Give
given her sacrifice.
Let's read from Matthew 27, starting at verse 27. The governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers round him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand, and then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spat on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. And after they'd mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. And then they led him away to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And there they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they'd crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lot, and sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" In the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. From noon until 3 PM, darkness came over all the land. About 3 PM, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge, and he filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone, and let's see if Elijah comes to save him." When Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Many women were there, watching from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered it to be given to him. Jesus took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there opposite the tomb. Hello folks, I'm Joel. I'm the minister here at Bentley Baptist Church. It's great to be connecting with you today. I'm a big fan of Lord of the Rings, the books, the films, just that whole world that Tolkien created. And at the end of the third Lord of the Rings film, Return of the King, I remember sitting in the cinema, and there's a scene where two of the main characters have completed part of their quest, and they're sitting on the side of a volcano. And I remember sitting and watching this film in the cinema as they're sitting there and they're reflecting on their journey. And then the scene slowly fades to black. And I remember loads of people in the cinema saying, "Well, is that it? Is that the end?" And some people go, "What? Come on." And some people actually started getting up and getting their coats to leave. And then the next scene rose. And people sat back and, okay. Because they didn't know the story. They didn't know the story of Lord of the Rings. They maybe hadn't read the book. They'd only seen the films. And I was sitting secure thinking, "No, I know this isn't the end. I know we're not there yet." And actually, Lord of the Rings, the third film, is famous for having these moments of conclusion. I think four or five of them at the end of the film, before the film actually finishes. There are quite a few films that like to use this. They like to have what seems to be the ending, and you think, what? No, it can't finish like that. And then it continues into the next scene with a better resolution. The death of Jesus on Good Friday is the false ending to the story of Jesus and the mission of God in the Bible. In so many ways, it seemed like the defeat, the end, and the death. But it was really the victory, a new beginning, and the prelude to resurrection life. Good Friday is also the resolution of the Christmas story. Or it seems to be the story of shepherds and wise men seeking out a newborn future king. Do you remember that? That was the whole thing about the journey of the wise men. They were looking for the future king of the Jews. Now, for most of his life, after the visit of the shepherds and the wise men, the idea of Jesus being a king, it seemed to have been put on hold. You know, everyone referred to him as the Messiah, as teacher, as prophet. But king doesn't really come up again after the visit of the wise men. But then finally, Palm Sunday comes and Jesus rides into Jerusalem on a donkey, fulfilling an ancient prophecy of how the Messiah would arrive. The king had come. The people celebrate, they're throwing their coats down, waving their palm branches in the air. But John's gospel tells us that they weren't actually celebrating him as the coming king. They'd missed the significance of Jesus fulfilling that prophecy. Actually, they'd gathered hoping Jesus would perform some more miracles like the resurrection of Lazarus. And of course, Jesus would perform another resurrection miracle. But we're not there yet. So Jesus enters on a donkey in this kingly procession. And then a few days later came Jesus' coronation as King of the Jews. But this was a coronation unlike any other. You see, Jesus was not proclaimed king with fanfare, honour and joy, but with torture, mockery and shame. He was taken after being falsely convicted by Roman soldiers at the order of Pontius Pilate, and he was brutally flogged until the flesh of his back was torn. And then it says in Matthew's gospel, a scarlet robe was thrown upon him, its colour matching that of Jesus' bloodied body. A crown of thorns was pressed onto his head, and then it was struck down with a staff in mockery of the giving of a royal sceptre of rule. And the royal procession of Jesus that day was not a procession of joy and glory, but an execution march, carrying his own cross, the cross upon which he would be crucified. And then as Jesus hung, nailed to the cross, wearing his crown of thorns, the Roman governor Pilate ordered a sign fastened to the cross that declared, in the most commonly spoken languages of the world for all to see and to read, "This is Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Now we read in John 19 that the Jewish leaders who'd had Jesus convicted, who'd arrested him, they complained about this sign. It says many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' write 'this man claims to be King of the Jews.'" But Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Some commentators have said that Pilate did this as a final snub to the Jewish leaders. But whatever his reasons, Pilate had declared the truth to the whole world. You see, Jesus had fulfilled all of the prophecies of Israel's promised Messiah king. He'd been declared king by angels, by wise men, by adoring crowds, by mocking soldiers, and by Pontius Pilate, Roman governor of Judah. Jesus' actual recorded death certificate, if you like, said he was the king of the Jews. And as Jesus hung upon the cross, the crown upon his head, watched by those who loved him, those who hated him, and those who were simply indifferent to him, he served humanity in a way no other king ever has before or will ever need to again. In his own words, Jesus cried out upon the cross, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." And in those words, Jesus summed up his whole mission as king. "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." I believe that Jesus, yeah, he was talking about that moment in his agony. "Father, forgive them for putting God on the cross. Forgive them. They don't actually know who I am. Forgive them. They don't understand what it is they're doing right now." But I believe there is a deeper meaning and understanding to those words as well, a bigger picture understanding. Jesus, by what he was doing on the cross, he defined it right there. "Father, forgive them for all of their sins, for they really don't know what they are doing. They don't understand." Isaiah 53 was a prophecy about Jesus, about this very moment. It was written 700 years before the birth of Jesus. Isaiah wrote this: "He was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We've left God's path to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. But he was struck down for the rebellion of my people. He had done no wrong and never deceived anyone. But he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and cause him grief. For when his life is made an offering for sin, he will have many descendants. He will enjoy long life, and the Lord's good plan will prosper in his hands. And when he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of his experience, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins." Do you hear all of the details in there about the beating, about the whipping, about the innocence, about the oppression, about being convicted despite having done nothing wrong? All of those details. Jesus had no choice in the crucifixion story about what was done to him. And yet it conformed to all of those prophecies. He was the one spoken of 700 years ago who would make it possible for many to be counted righteous because he would bear all their sins. In the New Testament, 2 Corinthians 5:21 sums it up like this: "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." And on that day, everyone watching believed it was the end of the story of Jesus. The disciples thought it was the end of Jesus' incredible ministry. The Jewish leaders thought it was the end of Jesus as a challenge to their religious authority. Pilate, Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor, he thought it was the end of Jesus as an irritation, a disruption to public order. And Satan, the devil, thought it was the end of Jesus' challenge to his rule and dominion over the world. But they were all wrong. As we now know, this was not the end of a story. This was not a defeat. There has never been a victory like the cross. Never such a triumph. Never such a glorious ending to a person's life. What better destiny could any human ask for than to save the entire race from death and destruction? What a glorious ending to the story of Jesus, a king who died for his people. But Jesus was not only a human king. This was a false ending to the narrative. On that Good Friday, Jesus had been placed in the tomb. The scene had faded to black. Yet the story hadn't finished. Because that was Friday. But Sunday is coming.
Thanks, Joel, for sharing that word with us this morning. We'd love to hear from you this week, so please do keep in touch. You'll find us on Facebook and Instagram, and of course our website, with a list of all our events that are coming up. Hope you have a fantastic week, and we'll see you on Sunday, for Easter Sunday. Bye!